Now we're recording. Okay. All right. Good morning, everyone. And we have once again Professor Kuznetsov, who will be speaking on exceptional collections.
Thank you very much. And I think we should all thank the organizers for this nice event, even if it is virtual. But still, it's very nice, I think. Thank you. And today I will talk about a special type of exceptional collections, which is called Lefschetz collections. So why are we interested in special types of exceptional collections? There are several reasons. So maybe the first reason that I should mention is the following. So assume that we have an exceptional collection in some triangulated category T. Then we can construct many other exceptional collections starting from this one. Namely, as we discussed on Monday, there are operations called left and right mutations through exceptional objects. And if you apply these mutations, you can produce from this collection, for instance, two others. So the first one will look like this. So essentially, you replace, this is n plus 2. You replace EI plus 1 that was standing here by its left mutation through EI and place it immediately to the left of EI. And it is easy to check that this is an exceptional collection. And similarly, you can, instead of this, take the right mutation of EI through EI plus 1. So then, this is minus 1. And here you can put the right mutation of EI through EI plus 1. And it is easy to check that these two operations are mutually inverse and they enjoy the braid group relations and they generate the braid group on n strands action on the set. On the set of all exceptional collections in T. So Bn, the braid group, acts on the set of n term exceptional collections in T. And in some cases, it is known that this action is simple transitive. So sometimes, you know, this action is up to sheaves of exceptional objects, of course. So for instance, this is true for T1 and T2. And in general, it is expected that it is always true. And this shows that as soon as we have one exceptional collection, we have very many of these, because typically we will have something like one or maybe several orbits of the braid group, and the braid group is a countable group, so we have countably many exceptional collections in general. And because there are so many of these exceptional collections, it is not so easy to find any of them. That's a kind of general paradox. If you want to find something which is unique, it is much easier than to find something which comes in huge families. This is the case. At least this is the case with the exceptional collections.
And Sasha?
Yes, yes.
When you say it's expected to be faithful, is that just on homogeneous varieties or in general?
We don't know enough examples.
Okay.
To say precisely, I would believe that it is faithful more or less always, but who knows? I mean, I'm not sure that this is known. I mean, I think this statement is known for P1, P2, and the Delpeza surfaces. And so the Delpeza surfaces are definitely not homogeneous in general.
Right.
But in higher dimensions, we have no results, only some vague expectations. Okay, so this is one of the reasons why it would be nice to have a more restrictive notion than just a notion of an of exceptional collection, because it would be easier to find things which are more restricted. And the notion of a Lefschetz collection is such more restrictive notion of an exceptional collection. So let me define it. You don't need to consider a homogeneous variety to define a Lefschetz collection. So let X be just some polarized variety, so X, and some ample line bundle, which I will denote by O quantum. Actually, it doesn't have to be ample. You can take any line bundle, but probably you won't get a reasonable notion unless O quantum is ample. Okay, so let us consider such a variety with a line bundle, and then a Lefschetz collection. In D of X, in the derived integer of X, is an exceptional collection that takes a special form. So the form is the following. So you start with with some collection, with some reasonable exceptional collection. And I will denote its length by sigma zero. Then you consider the same objects, but you twist each of them by O of one. Twist means that you tensor product. And maybe you stop a bit earlier. So you stop at E sigma one, twisted by one, where sigma one maybe is a bit less than sigma zero. Then you twist by two and stop again, maybe a bit zero, and so on. So the last portion will look like this. So these pieces of the collection will be called blocks. So this is block zero, and I will also call it starting block. This is block one, block two, and so on, block n minus one. And sigma zero, sigma one, this will be a non-increasing sequence of integers. It will be called the support partition. Of this collection. Lefschetz collection. So I will abbreviate it to LC. Okay, so this is the definition. And let me give you an example. So the simplest example, of course, is the example of the projective space with line bundle O of one. Then we can take the standard exception collection the Beilinson exception collection. As we remember, it has this form. So definitely it is a Lefschetz exceptional collection where each block consists of a single exceptional object. So in this case, the support partition is just one repeated n plus one times. Right? So this is like the prototypic example of a Lefschetz exceptional collection. Let me give you another example.
Sasha, in your definition, what's n?
Is the that was my question also.
N? What is n? Some integer. I mean,
it doesn't have to be the dimension.
Typically, in examples, this will be something like maximal divisibility of the canonical class, and O1 will be the corresponding fraction of the anticanonical class. Yeah. So, for instance, you see for the projective space n. Yeah, so here m is n plus 1. Okay? So this is precisely the divisibility of the canonical class of the projective space. Is that clear?
Thanks.
Hello?
Yes. Yeah, that was great. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let me give you another example. So maybe let us take X to be some Grassmannian, say, for instance, Grassmannian 2-5. Unfortunately, I didn't have time yesterday to explain how the Kapranov's exceptional collection looks on Grassmannians. I will definitely speak about this today, but let me tell you what happens for this particular Grassmannian. Here the exception collection takes the following form, the Kapranov's collection. So we take the structure sheaf, the dual tautological bundle, its symmetric square, its symmetric cube, then O of 1, U dual of 1, S only dual of 1, O of 2. So was that right? And you see here the starting block consists of four vector bundles. The next block consists of three vector bundles, then two vector bundles, and the last block consists of one vector bundle. So in this case, n is 4, b to 1, right? So in particular, in this case, m is not the divisibility of the canonical class, but this is not necessary in general. So you see that many exceptional collections that appear in practice have this Lefschetz structure. And this is also an important warning that Lefschetz is not a property, but it is a structure. So this is structure, not property. By this, I mean that the same exceptional collection can be considered as
Sasha, can you hear us? Sasha, can you hear us?
He's muted.
Oh, you're muted?
I don't know what happened. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you now.
We lost you
right after you were telling us about Lefsche structure, not property.
So I was just saying that the same exception collection can have several structures of a Lefsche collection. For instance, you could put all objects into the starting block. You can consider the starting block to be the entire collection. This is a Lefsche structure, but it is a kind of stupid one. Or, for instance, for the projective space, you could put several line bundles into the starting block as well, and then the rest will be in other blocks. That's an important thing. Let me tell you several useful facts about Lefschetz collections. So I think that the definition should be clear, so let me erase it. Okay, some facts. The first thing is that, in fact, Lefschetz collection is completely determined by its first block. By this starting collection of objects. Of course, if you know the starting block and the support partition, then it is clear that everything is determined by this. But in fact, the support partition is also determined by the starting block. You can write down an explicit procedure that will reconstruct you the entire Lefschetz collection from this starting block. So for instance, if you start with a structure sheaf on a projective space, then there is a unique way to extend it to a Lefschetz collection. And similarly here, as soon as you specify that you want the first block to be generated by these four particular vector bundles, there is only one way to extend it to a Lefschetz collection. So again, there is a warning that if you just take some random exception collection and will try to extend it to a Lefschetz one, most probably you will fail. Not every exceptional collection extends to a Lefschetz one. If you want this collection to form the starting block. So this is not so straightforward. So the second
fact, Sasha.
Yes?
To reconstruct the partition, would you just include as many as possible? And if it breaks being an exceptional collection, then you stop?
Precisely.
And this doesn't necessarily give a full collection or anything like that. So yes.
You should see.
Oh, full one is okay.
Yeah. Without fullness, this is of course not true. You just can drop one of the objects from some of blocks, and for instance, you can forget about the last block, and of course, this is still will be a Lefschetz collection. Yeah. Fullness is important here. Okay. Second fact, which is also obvious, is that. If you have a Lefschetz collection and if you want to check that it is exceptional, you need to verify much less vanishings than for an arbitrary exceptional collections. So to verify exceptionality, you need much less verifications. Essentially because Lefschetz exceptional collection has this partial symmetry. With most objects, we have the same objects twisted by one, two, and so on. And so if you want to check that two objects which are twists, to check that they are semi-orthogonal, you can untwist them back and basically, when you want to check exceptionality of a Lefschetz collection, you can always take the second argument to be in the starting block. That's enough. I mean, if all objects are semi-orthogonal to the starting block, then it is already exceptional. So you need to verify much less. And of course, when verifications are complicated, this helps a lot. And the third fact that I wanted to mention, in fact, this third observation was like the main motivation to consider these Lefschetz collections is the following. So assume that XH in X is a divisor in the linear system corresponding to the line bundle of one. Yeah, so this is just the zero locus of a section of this line bundle. Then it is easy to check that if you restrict all, if you restrict this Lefschetz collection to XH and remove the starting block, this will also be an exceptional collection. So if you take E1 restricted to XH, and so on, this is still an exceptional collection in the derived category of XH. And this is very useful in some sense. You know something about X and you obtain for free some exceptional collection on its hyperplane section. Of course, in general, this restricted exceptional collection will not be full. For instance, if you apply this procedure to the stupid Lefschetz collection, then everything is in the first block. Then since there are no other blocks, what you get is zero. But if your Lefschetz collection has many bundles out of the starting block, then you obtain something useful. And for instance, coming back to homogeneous varieties, there are several examples when a hyperplane section of a homogeneous variety is a homogeneous variety for a smaller group. For instance, if you take Grassmannian 2n, Grassmannian 2, 2n, then its hyperplane section, its general hyperplane section, is the symplectic Grassmannian 2, 2n. Or if you take the Faenza Manivelle homogeneous variety E6 mod P1, then its hyperplane section is F4 mod P4. So, and using this observation, you for free obtain an exceptional collection in these more complicated homogeneous varieties. And in fact, in these two particular examples, the collection turns out to be full. So in some sense, you solve your problem without much effort. Of course, proving fullness is not automatic in this situation, but at least the construction comes for free. Okay, and also this observation, I mean, from this point of view, one Lefschetz collection is better than the other if this part of this collection is bigger than for another one. Or equivalently, if the starting block is smaller. And so this defines your natural ordering on the set of all Lefschetz collections. So assume that I have two Lefschetz collections. One I will denote by E, comma sigma, and another one E prime, comma sigma prime. I will say that the first is less or equal than the second if the starting block of the first is a subcollection in the starting block of the second. This is a well-defined partial order, and from the point of view of this observation, the best Lefschetz collection is the one which has the smallest possible starting block, and in other words, a minimal Lefschetz collection with respect to this partial ordering. So, in other words, the slogan is the smaller your Lefschetz collection, the better. And let me give you another definition. So I will say that a Lefschetz collection is rectangular if its support partition is constant. So in some sense, you can you can think of this support partition as of a Young diagram, and then this condition is just saying that this Young diagram is a rectangle. So in some sense, rectangular Lefschetz collections behave better than general Lefschetz collections. But of course, if you want to construct a rectangular Lefschetz collection, you need a kind of divisibility condition, right? Because at least if you want your rectangular collection to be full, then the length of the entire exception collection, which is the rank of the Grothendieck group of your category, should be divisible by n. Otherwise, you have no chance. So because of this, there are situations when you can't construct rectangular Lefschetz collections. But if you can, this is the most useful situation. Sometimes you cannot construct a full rectangular Lefschetz collection, but you can construct a kind of maximal possible rectangular exceptional collection. And then it makes sense to consider its orthogonal. So let us assume that the dualizing sheaf of our variety, or maybe the anti-canonical line bundle, is isomorphic to OX of N. And assume that we have a rectangular Lefschetz collection in D of X, maybe not full, but of length N. Is a rectangular of length N. So, like before. Then we define the residual category for this rectangular Lefschetz collection as the orthogonal of the category generated by this exception collection, E1 and so on, is sigma 0. Sigma n minus 1, which is also n sigma 0. Yeah, so let us consider this orthogonal category. So that's like the remaining part of the category which is not generated by this Lefschetz collection. The main observation about this residual category, so this is called residual category. And the main property is that it also has the structure which is very similar to the original structure that you have in your variety. So, namely, this is a proposition that this residual category has a natural autoequivalence I will call it tau r, which is defined as follows. So it acts on an object f as follows. So first of all, you twist this object by one, and then you if you twist it by one in the direct category of x, of course it will no longer be in the residual category, right? Because the twist will destroy this orthogonality property defining the residual category. But it's easy to see from the Lefschetz property that it will be not orthogonal only to the first block of your rectangular collection. It will be automatically orthogonal to the other blocks, but the first block will be problematic. But now we can just mutate this object to the octagonal of this first block, and then it will be an object of the residual category as well. So we mutate this with respect to E sigma zero, then with respect to E sigma zero minus one, and so on, and then with respect to E one. And this will be an object of the residual category again. I mean, from this definition, it is not clear that this is indeed an outer equivalence, but you can prove this. So this is not hard, but it requires some computation. And also, this outer equivalence has the property very similar to this one. If you raise it to the power m, then this autoequivalence will be isomorphic to the inverse Serre functor of the category R up to shift. So when is the Serre functor. So in some sense, this autoequivalence tau r plays the same role in the residual category as the twist by O of one plays in the category D of x. And moreover, there is a bijection between extensions of, say, this original rectangular collection to a bigger Lefschetz collection in the embedded category, and Lefschetz collections with respect to tau r in r. So, so in some sense, if you haven't yet constructed a full Lefschetz collection, but you know some nice rectangular Lefschetz collection, then you can reduce the further study to this residual category. So what you need to extend this Lefschetz collection to a full Lefschetz collection is equivalent to constructing a Lefschetz collection in this category R. So in this sense, this is a useful procedure to pass to this residual category whenever you can. Now, let me go back to homogeneous varieties. So what is known about Lefschetz collections on homogeneous varieties? Back to G mod T. So what do we know? Maybe let me start with examples. So maybe one of the first exceptional collections in on homogeneous varieties was the exceptional collection constructed by Kapranov on Grassmannians. So let me tell you how they look like. So if we consider the derived category of the Grassmannian, then what Kapranov proved is that the following collection of vector bundles is a full exceptional collection. It is very similar to the collection that we considered for Grassmannian 2.5. So we just need to consider all sure functors applied to the dual tautological bundle, where lambda, and this highest weights lambda, have this inequalities. So as usual, it is a non-increasing sequence of integers, but now we just need to assume that they have these inequalities. And pictorially, you can just think of this non-increasing sequence of integers as of a Young diagram, So it will be something like this. Here, lambda 1 is just the length of the first row, lambda 2 is the length of the second row, and so on. And then these conditions that lambda k is non-negative and lambda 1 does not exceed n minus k just means that this Young diagram is inscribed into a rectangle with n minus k columns and k rows. Yeah, I mean, pictures of this sort will always show up when you study Grassmannians. And it is not so surprising that it also appears in the construction of an exceptional collection. So Kapranov's collection is a full exceptional collection in the Grassmannian. Its length is n choose k, so the number of Young diagrams inscribed into such a rectangle is easily seen to be n choose k. And the nature of Lefschetz structure on this exceptional collection is just to consider the first block consisting of, I mean, so you can take sigma z, E1 and so on, E sigma 0 to be just the set of sigma lambda double such that we have this the same conditions, lambda 1, maybe the lambda 2, and so on. And of course, lambda k to be 0. Okay, so if you force lambda k to be 0, that means that the last row is empty. And then since that list corresponds to adding a full column on the left, it follows that this is indeed a Lefschetz collection. And here you see that sigma 0 is just n minus 1 choose k minus 1. And sigma 1 is n minus 2 choose k minus 2, and so on. So the fact that these blocks sum up to the entire collection corresponds combinatorially to the equality that this binomial coefficient is the sum of smaller binomial coefficients. Okay, this is the Kapranov's exception collection, and it has this Lefschetz structure, but the point is that this Lefschetz structure is very far from being minimal. I mean, it is definitely very far from being rectangular, and it is also very far from being minimal. So to show you how can a smaller Lefschetz collection look like, let me go back to the example of Grassmannian 2-pi. Then what you can check is that there is the following Lefschetz collection. So you start with O and U dual, then you take O of 1, U dual of 1, and so on, and you finish with O of 4 and U dual of 4. So you can take five blocks consisting of two objects each. And you can check that this is also a full exceptional collection, and definitely it is smaller than the original Kapranov's collection, and it is also rectangular. So it is much better for many purposes than the original Kapranov's collection. And there is a generalization of this example to other Grassmannians, which is due to Anton von Eder. So let me explain his construction. So there is a beautiful combinatorial construction that allows you to construct a much smaller Lefschetz collection for any Grassmannian. And the combinatorics is quite beautiful. So let me denote the set of such exceptional such highest weights by PKN. So, and now let me observe the following. So let us think of this set as about paths that go in this rectangle from its upper right corner to its bottom left corner. Paths going along the standard grid. Okay? Then note that there is a Z mod n action. So the cyclic group Z mod n acts on this set. So it is defined as follows. So so assume that we have our rectangle and a path going from one corner to the other. Now what we can do, we can just extend this path periodically. And so this is one period, this is other period, and so on. And we can think about this picture as about a periodic path on the infinite grid and a frame that shows you where you are looking at. Yeah, so let us think of this rectangle as a kind of frame such that its upper half and upper right and lower left corners are fixed to the path. Then because the path is periodic, you can move this rectangle a bit to the right or along the path in the upper right direction or in the lower left direction. And if you move it by one step, you will get a different path in the same rectangle. And if you move it n times, then because of periodicity, you will obtain the same path as before. So this defines an action of this cyclic group on this set of paths. And if you want to write it by a formula, then this is also quite easy. So if you have this collection of integers that satisfy this property, then the generator of this group takes it either to number 1 plus 1 and so on, number k plus 1. If this addition of 1 does not violate this defining property, so if number k is less than, strictly less than n minus k. In this case, you just add 1. To every entry, and otherwise you just remove the first row. So you consider number 2, and so on, number k, and put 0 at the end. Otherwise, so you can check that this action defined by this formula is equivalent to this action defined pictorially, and it shows that this is indeed an action of this group. And now what Fanarov is doing, he suggests to consider orbits of this action and choose the minimal representative in each orbit. So let P mean Kn be the set of lexicographically minimal representatives of orbits in Z and N orbits in EKN. And then he proves that this is this gives you a Lefschetz collection. If you take sigma lambda u du, where lambda belongs to this set of minimal representatives, then this is extends, this is the starting block. And moreover, you can say how many times each object repeats in this Lefschetz collection. In fact, the number it repeats is precisely the length of the corresponding orbits. So altogether, the total number of objects in this Lefschetz collection is just the sum of lengths of orbits, and therefore it is the expected number n choose p. So this is the first result he proves. And if you look how, what does it give for particular gross minions, you can observe that the situation is the best possible when K and M are coprime. So if GCD of K and M is one, so if they are coprime, then several nice things happen. So first of all, the action on PKM is free. So why is it so? Because if the action is not free, then there is some non-trivial element in this group and some pair which is stabilized by this element. But what that means is that this n-periodic path has actually a smaller period than n. And if its period is n divided by r, then it is clear that k is also divisible by r. And so k and m are not coprime. So this is more or less obvious. Second useful observation in this case is that this set, under this assumption, every orbit has a unique upper triangular representative. And upper triangular just means that if you draw your rectangle, and if you also draw the diagonal in this rectangle that goes from one corner to the other, then the corresponding Young diagram lives in this lives above this diagonal. And moreover, the upper triangular representative is also lexicographically minimal. And for instance, if you consider the example of Grassmannian 2-5, it allows you very easily to find this representatives. You just draw the diagonal. And so if you want your Young diagram to be above the diagonal, it should be inscribed in this very small square. And so there are precisely two such Young diagrams. One is empty and it corresponds to the structure sheaf, and one is this one box diagram which corresponds to the dual tautological bundle. So this is how you reconstruct the example of Grassmannian 2-5 from this point of view. And the third, maybe the most important observation is that in this case, what Fanarev proved is that Lefschetz collection is full. Of course, we expect that all these collections are full just because they have the expected length. But as we discussed yesterday, the fact that the length is, maybe 2 days ago, we discussed that the fact that the length is expected does not prove that the collection is full. It is nature of the expected is full in this case, but it may be not so easy to prove. So by now, Fanarev proved fullness only under this simplifying assumption. I believe he will also prove it in the general situation, but I'm not sure of that. Okay, it is full and also rectangular. So in some sense, the situation with when K and N are coprime is very well understood by now for Grassmannians. Of course, it would be very nice to find something similar for other homogeneous varieties. So as you see, the crucial combinatorial construction here is that is this cyclic group action on the set of all Young diagrams. So it would be very nice to find something similar for general G mod P. So of course the analog of this rectangle is just the set of all Schubert classes for the cohomology, and this is just the coset of one wild group with respect to another wild group. But the cyclic group that acts should be the cyclic group of order equal to the divisibility of the canonical class, but I have no idea how to define the section in general. There should be some combinatorial rule which is completely not clear to me. So if someone has an idea, please let me know. I think this should be some interesting combinatorial extension of the theory of wild groups. Okay. So, as I said, when the greatest common divisor of K and M is one, the story is quite simple. We have this very nice full Lefschetz, full and rectangular Lefschetz collection in the derived category of the Grassmannian. So, what happens when GCD of K and M is not one? So, if in this case, it is natural to consider the rectangular part of this Lefschetz collection. Which means that let us consider only those lambda in this set which have orbit of length m, and consider the Lefschetz collection generated by this short functors of U dual, and ask what can we tell, what can we say about the residual category? And there is a conjecture about the residual category for this collection. It was suggested in our work with Maxim Smirnov, that the residual category is generated by a completely orthogonal exceptional collection. So this complete orthogonality is kind of unexpected expectation because, in general, when you consider some triangulated pedigree and an exceptional collection in it, it almost never will be completely orthogonal. Completely orthogonal means that you don't have extension spaces, not only from right to left in this collection, but also from left to right. In fact, this just means that this category is derived equivalent to the derived category of several disjoint points. So this is a very restrictive statement. And in fact, in the same paper, we proved that this is true in the simplest possible situation when the greatest common divisor is not one. this is true for k when k is a prime number. So if you consider Grassmannian comma pn, this is true. And again, as far as I know, Komarov is working on the on proving this in general situation, and maybe this will be achieved at some point. Okay, so how much time? My time is over. So maybe to finish, let me just say that this conjecture has a mirror symmetry explanation. I mean, you can call it proof in quotation marks. And you can find it in our paper with Maxim. And also, if you follow this mirror symmetry considerations, then this conjecture can be extended to a wider class of varieties. And for instance, another conjecture of this sort, maybe let me state it vaguely. That for simply laced groups, AN, DN, and EN, one can construct some specific parabolics which are called adjoint parabolic subgroups. One can construct Lefschetz collections such that the residual category will be equivalent to the derived category of representations of the corresponding fields. AN or DN or EN. And we proved this conjecture in types A and D, but not in type A, E, because in type E we don't know enough. So let me just finish by saying that this asking for this additional Lefschetz property makes the theory much more rich. There are relations to mirror symmetry, to quantum cohomology of these homogeneous varieties, and beautiful combinatorics appears. And so I think this is a very nice subject. Okay, so let me finish here.
Okay, let's give a nice round of applause to Professor Kuznetsov and his many excellent talks this week. Are there any other questions for him?
Sasha, is there a way of going from like an Lefschetz collection, like say in GRKN to GRKN minus one, or like from going like a quadric in dimension n to a quadric in dimension n minus one?
For quadrics, it is in some sense easy because whenever you have, because a quadric in dimension n minus one is just a hyperplane section of a quadric in dimension n, right?
And but what about the isotropic spaces? Like, you know, if you look at isotropic spaces in the quadric contained in a quadric, would be a way of going from Dn to Bn.
Yeah. Then this question is similar to the question about Grassmannians, and this is a very nice question, in fact, because this property of Lefschetz, the relation between Lefschetz collections and hyperplane sections that I mentioned is indeed very useful. Now, if you want to go, say, from Grassmannian Kn to Grassmannian Kn minus one, this is not a hyperplane section anymore. But this is a similar situation. This is the zero locus of the vector bundle U dual. And so you can ask, what can you say about, can you somehow restrict, maybe take some subcollection of your Lefschetz collection that will have nice property for zero loci of such vector bundles? And I'm sure that there is some relation of this sort, but I don't know how to describe it. So this is definitely a very nice question to think about. And I think it will be very useful because as you mentioned, many interesting varieties can appear in this form as zero loci of some vector bundles or some equivariant, maybe vector bundles on Grassmannians or things like this. So if you will be able to construct exception collections on them in this way, it will be a very powerful technique. Also, I should probably mention that a relation of this sort is often used for proof of fullness of exceptional collections. Basically, if you want to prove that some exceptional collection on Grassmannian Kn is full, and if you know that it has some nice relation to exceptional collections on smaller Grassmannians like Grassmannian Kn minus one, then sometimes you can deduce fullness of the bigger Lefschetz collection. So relations of this sort are useful both for constructing new exceptional collections and also for proving fullness. So this is definitely a very good question to think about.
Thanks.
Sasha, you said earlier in the week that you had exceptional collections of the expected length with Polishchuk. Does that follow any of this of today's patterns, or are those Lefschetz?
No. It also has a kind of block structure. So it is constructed as several blocks, and each block has its own twist. But the blocks do not form a chain. So, mm-hmm. So for instance, maybe let me tell you how it looks for Lagrangian Grassmannians. So for Lagrangian Grassmannians, which are in my notation, are these Grassmannians. So as I mentioned earlier, the expected length is 2 to the power n, so it should be a huge exceptional collection. And the picture is the following. So let us consider denote by BA the rectangle of the size A times n minus A. And let us consider the subcategory generated by all sigma lambda U dual, where lambda is a Young diagram inside this rectangle. So which means that we have a chain of inequalities as before. And let me denote the category generated by these objects by AA. A with index A. Maybe let me switch to K because it sounds weird. And then the exceptional collection that we constructed with Polishchuk, it is a refinement of a semi-orthogonal decomposition that looks like this. So this is how it looks. So for instance, the combinatorial identity behind fullness of this exceptional collection that was recently proved by Fonerov is that n choose 0 plus n choose 1 plus n choose 2 plus n choose 4 plus n choose n is 2 to the power n. So you see that decomposition of the total length among the blocks is very non-trivial. So first the blocks grow and then they start getting smaller, and they are not embedded into each other. They have non-trivial intersections, but the pattern is different. And also I should say that these objects by themselves are not exceptional. In fact, you need to kind of change bases in these subcategories to an exceptional basis. And you can do it by applying procedure, which is based on a relation between the equivalent derived category of Grassmannian and the usual derived category. So in fact, I hoped to explain this yesterday, but I ran out of time, so I couldn't. But the picture for Lagrangian Grassmannians is quite beautiful, I think. And definitely this exceptional collection that we constructed is an analog of Kapranov's exceptional collection here. Mm-hmm. It is not an analog of Lepschitz's collection.
Thank you.
Any more questions? All right, if not, let's thank Sasha one more time.
Thank you for listening. Mm-hmm. It was-